Sorry for the delay. We were just trying to wait a bit so that people could join in, but we'll proceed. And I guess along the way, people can join in and, you know, catch up or something. Okay, so hello everyone, good morning. On behalf of the trustees of RDSF, I welcome you to today's session. This is our Q1 2021 session of the RDSF Skills and Capacity Development Program. So I'll just do a bit of introduction about Rehoboth Dream Solid Foundation. The foundation is a nonprofit, nonpartisan, non-governmental foundation which engages in charitable activities to advance the social and economic well-being of the less privileged in the society. We do this through the promotion of sustainable education, mentoring, and skills and capacity development. Today's webinar is part of our mentoring and capacity development program. Along the line during the webinar, some questions will pop up on the screen and we request that you kindly respond to them promptly so that we can proceed. Also, there will be a survey of just 5 questions that will be shared after the event, just to enable you to give us feedback on today's event and, you know, and how we can do better and improve on, you know, our future webinars. One more thing, after the webinar, we are going to select 50 participants to undertake a more detailed training on digital marketing. And Edison Egere, who is the manager, the RDSF manager, will explain this later during the webinar. So I would now like to introduce today's presenter, Mr. Babatunde Ogunowo, who is a very experienced digital marketing personnel. And he will take us on this topic. Please pay attention and make the most of this event. You'll be glad you signed up. Mr. Babatunde Ogunowo, the stage is yours.
Okay, all right. So good morning, everyone. First, I'd like to thank the NGO, the trustees of the NGO for giving me and all of us, everyone who wants to learn today, the opportunity. This kind of opportunity, right? An opportunity to impact people and basically learn from each other, right? So without wasting much of our time, let me just go straight into the session. But first, let me introduce myself. My name is Babatunde Ogunowo. Even though I'm popularly called Tuni Ogunowo, I'm a digital marketing strategist, and I've been into digital marketing unofficially since 2012. That would be about 8 to 9 years, basically, and professionally since 2016, basically. So, applied so that at least we can follow through all I'll be saying. If you are using a phone to participate, when I begin to share my slide, you might want to tilt your phone in the landscape mode, so you're able to see what's on the screen. Edison, I can't, it's saying here that the host has disabled participants from sharing screen. I can't share my screen. Edison, can you work on that? Edison, are you here?
Yes, I can hear you. Kindly proceed. I'll try to do that from here.
Okay. Once I'm able to share my screen, just let me know. But I'll proceed currently. I'll proceed with this. All right. So firstly, I want to let us know that this session is an overview of what digital marketing is about. Right. Just to get us acquainted to what digital marketing is about. You know, so many times people tell you digital marketing is Facebook. Go and run Facebook adverts. Go and run Instagram adverts. Go and do these things, and they just make you. All right. Good. Thank you. So they just make you feel like, Edison, will you be controlling my screen, my slide from your end?
Yes, you can proceed. Mrs. Komolafe is sharing the screen for you.
All right.
Yes, all right, so, go ahead. Just let me know which slide you want me to stay on.
Okay. You can move to the third slide, the third one. So, So most time people think that digital marketing is about being able to run Facebook ads, being able to run Instagram ads and things like that, right? And that's a misconception, right? Digital marketing is way, way broader than just being able to use Facebook or being able to use Instagram, right? And that's the reason why we're having this kind of session, to give us an overview, a full overview of what digital marketing is about. And so we can understand this basically, right? And then maybe later on, those who are interested in the practical class, we take a practical class. So first, so before digital marketing came, there was marketing, right? The internet, even in a country like Nigeria, the internet is, I'm not sure it's more, it's up to, but the internet is up to 15 years in Nigeria, right? There had been marketing before digital came on top of it, right? And marketing, if I ask us what's marketing here, most of us will say things like marketing is how to advertise your business, how to get people aware of your business, how to let people know your business and things like that, right? And actually, that's not what marketing is, right? The reason why people get marketing wrong is because in the first place, people don't understand what marketing is, right? And marketing is much more than how to create awareness. Because if you say that marketing is how to create awareness for your business, then what will you define as advertising, right? Because advertising is about creating awareness. Advertising is about getting people aware, letting people know, right? Or promoting your business. That's what advertising is. But marketing is way, way more than that, right? Advertising is just part of marketing, all right? If I'm fast, please, you can say it in the chat box, please, in the chat box. I'm reading the chat box, so you can drop questions, you can I can attend the questions as I move on. I'm reading the chat box too. So marketing is way more than what advertising is, right? So what's marketing basically? Marketing is every activity that a brand does to achieve their brand goals, basically. Every activity they do to achieve their personal or business brand goals. So as a business, the summation of all activities you do to achieve your business goals, to achieve all your business goals is what marketing is about, right? So if you look at that, you see that advertising is one of the things businesses do to achieve their business goals, right? Selling itself, like the process of exchanging the products or services for money, is also a part of the activity that businesses do to achieve their business goals, right? Even after sales services, things like maybe you buy something, maybe you buy a CCTV camera, and then the person you bought it from is telling you that they can help you, they can give you free installation, they can help you come and install it, right? Those are services that businesses give to people after selling, right? And these are things that businesses, these are activities, this is also, this after service, after selling services are also things that, also activities that businesses do to achieve their business goals, right? And there are other things. Bigger businesses, we have things like CSR. We know what CSRs are. CSR is corporate social responsibility, right? So these are all activities that businesses do to achieve their goals. So a summation of all these things put together is what marketing is, all right? So marketing is not just about advertising. It's the summation of everything, right? Now we know what marketing is, right? These are activities that businesses do to achieve their business goals, right? And it can be a personal brand too, right? We have people who have personal brands, people like our celebrities, musicians, those guys have personal brands, right? So for them, marketing for them will be the activities they do to achieve their personal brand goals, right? So marketing can be done for a business brand or a personal brand either way, right? So now what digital marketing is all these marketing activities done on the internet media or the new media, or the digital media, they all mean the same thing. Digital media, internet media, new media, they all mean the same thing. Now, all these marketing activities done on the internet media or digital media is what digital marketing is, right? And all of these activities that we've mentioned, if you begin to do them on the internet using your smartphones, your laptop, your tablets, that's what digital marketing basically is. And you can see it says digital marketing is, it makes use of electronic devices, computers, such as personal computers, smartphones, cell phones, to engage stakeholders. Next slide, please. All right. So the first thing I like to tell people before I convince them about digital marketing is to show them what the landscape is, basically, right? Now, this has started getting in January 2021. That's just about 4 months ago, right? There are over 7.8 billion people in the world, right? And active mobile phone users is about 5.2 billion. An active internet user is about 4.6 billion. So it means that even up to half or more than half of the world population are on the internet. And that's because the way we consume content has changed over time from TV and radio, all these traditional media platforms, TV, radio, print media, billboards and all that. The way we consume content has changed from those media platforms to the internet media platform. And the reason for that is not far-fetched. It's because the internet media makes content more snackable and timely. Do you understand? For instance, if you want to know what's happening in Nigeria, I don't know if all of us here are Nigerians, but let me just use Nigeria as an example because I'm in Nigeria. All right. So if you want to get news around Nigeria, for instance, you want to know what's happening in Nigeria, right? And you are only relying on TV or radio, right? You're probably waiting for the next news bulletin, which will be by, let's say, 12 o'clock, right? But whenever something happens on internet, the news breaks immediately and everybody knows what's happening, right? So it means that content are shared better on the internet, or content are consumed better on the internet. And the internet makes it easy for both the content creator and the content consumer. The content creator here are the businesses, right? I'm just trying to give an overview before I go down to digital marketing for businesses. So the internet makes it easy for the content creator and the content consumer to create and consume content. Because for instance, if we had no internet and I want to create content for people to consume, I'll probably, if I don't have money for TV or radio or billboard and all those media platforms, I'll probably go from door to door, go from street to street, sharing flyers, talking to people and sharing flyers. Now imagine how long it would take me to reach out to 1,000 people or 2,000 people using that kind of strategy. Right, I'll probably even see some people and they're not in the mood to listen to me. They just collect my flyer. We know what we do with flyers now, Abby. We just collect them and then we trash them immediately, or we use them to wrap the next snack we're buying on the road. All right. So the internet has come to like help us with this kind of problems. On the internet, you can reach out to people easily without leaving your home, without being under the sun. All right. And the good thing about the internet is that even if the person is not in the mood to listen to you at a particular time, the person can maybe do a screenshot of the message, or do a bookmark your website, do a screenshot, and just come back to the content whenever they are ready for the content. Right. Next slide. All right. So now going down to Nigeria, right? I know what they tell us, what they used to tell us is that we are 180 million people, but it looks like we're more than that because census have been done a long time ago. So we are over 200 million people, right? And even as we think that Nigeria, a country like Nigeria is, how do I put it? I don't know if I should use this kind of statement, but let me just use it because let me be realistic a bit, right? Yeah, we have a large concentration of poor people in a country like Nigeria, right? And even as we think that poverty rate in Nigeria is high, right, we still have a very high internet penetration. It means that even as some people will not have money to feed, and they still have money to like subscribe on the internet and come online, because it has gotten to the point where we are almost, we feel practically useless without being online. That's gotten to that point. Right, we feel like without the internet, we feel cut off from the real world without being online. So we want to subscribe, want to be online because we feel like we feel more connected when we are online. And the truth is that if you think that you're currently spending so much on data, just wait for the next 5 or 10 years, you'll be spending much more than what you're spending currently on data. Because look at the last 10 years. 10 years ago, you are probably spending just 1/10 of how much you're spending on data right now. 10 years ago, we were spending 1,000 on data doing BlackBerry BIS. I don't know if you remember those phones, BlackBerry BIS. It's just 1,000, 1,002. And you run that for the whole month. And most of them, you don't even know, they give us gigabytes. They give us about 3 gig. And you won't finish that 3 gig for the whole month. Most of us don't finish it. But right now, I'm sure you know that 3 gig can't even last you for up to 2 weeks right now. Once you connect to your laptop, it's gone, right? And the reason for that is because the things we do on the internet has become much more than we used to do. 10 years ago, there was no Uber. 10 years ago, there was no Taxify. 10 years ago, there was no Conga. I don't know. I think there was Conga. No, there was no Conga 10 years ago. There was no Conga. There was no Jumia. Right, most of these digital innovations we're seeing currently that helps that are helping businesses they were not there 10 years ago, right? So that's why, as we continue to proceed, there'll be more innovations, right, which will actually make us want to embrace the internet much more, right? Next slide. All right, so this is just the annual growth, the annual digital growth for a country like Nigeria. Right? Our total population is growing by 2.6% this year, and you can see that internet users grew by 22.1%. This to tell you that even the rate at which internet penetration is growing is even much more than our population growth. Next slide. Next slide again. I'm trying to summarize this. Next slide. All right, good. So these are now I want to, like, from here onward, I'm trying to like give you an overview of what the digital landscape in Nigeria is like, so that you know when you want to, when you take the practical digital marketing course, you know the platforms that you should be using to market your business. You know the platform that people are on, you know the platforms like that Nigerians are on, because when you're doing marketing, you are going on platforms where eyes are on. Right, so you're going to a platform where there's a community of people that you want to reach out to, right? So I'm trying to show us this so that you know when you begin to practice these things that you learn from the practical class, you know the platforms that you should pay more attention to, right? So one of the most popular websites in Nigeria is google.com, for obvious reasons. We all know that Google is a very popular brand, followed by Bet Ninja, for those who know Bet Ninja, followed by YouTube. This was gotten by a brand called Alexa. Alexa is a website that helps us to rank websites in the world based on how much traffic they get, right? So there's google.com number one, there's Bet Ninja, there's YouTube, Yahoo, Facebook.com. So if you look at this list, these are platforms that you actually know, right? But I'm just showing us this list to let you know that these are the platforms that Nigerians spend most of their time on. All right, next slide. I'm sorry if I'm fast, because this is just an overview of what digital marketing is, but I'm sure you still be able to learn a thing or two, right, as we proceed, right? And for those who will take the practical class, there's still an introductory session, a very expository introductory session inside the practical class. So this is just like an overview or a summary. All right, next slide again. All right, so the next thing is Google search queries. Now, search queries are the things that people are searching for on Google, right? So I'm trying to let us see the words that people are, the keywords. We call them keywords in digital marketing. When you look at words that people search for actively on Google, we call those kind of words keywords, right? So you might have been hearing keywords. That's what they mean. Just words that people use to search for things on the internet, right? If you're searching for social media, you probably use words like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, social media, all those kind of words. Those are keywords, right? So number one here is download, followed by news, followed by Nigeria, followed by Bet Ninja, followed by Hausa, followed by BBC, LiveScore, BBC Hausa, Chelsea, Facebook, Love, Live, Bet Ninja. So these are words that people, that Nigerians, sorry, search for the most. Right. These are not all the words that Nigerians search for. These are the words that Nigerians search for the most last year on Google. Last year, you can see it says top queries in 2020. Right. The one for this year will be released next year. Right. By Google themselves. Next slide. Can we leave this? Next slide again. I want to go away from this. Okay. Good. Good. Can we go back to the 13th slide? Okay, good. Now, I think this is the part that's very, very important for those who are trying to go digital, especially if you are trying to, let's say you have a business, or even if you are trying to go into digital marketing as a career, you need to know the platform that Nigerians spend most of their time on, right? And number one on that list is WhatsApp, for obvious reasons. We all know that almost everybody is on WhatsApp. Almost everybody that's on the internet is on WhatsApp. There's no way you say that you have a smartphone, you subscribe to data, and you say you're not on WhatsApp, then what are you doing on your phone, right? So almost everybody, and it's because it is easy to use, right? The old, the younger ones, everybody can use WhatsApp. Everybody knows what WhatsApp is, right? Even though there are still much more to WhatsApp than we actually know, because you can use WhatsApp for marketing and branding too, but we'll go into that in the practical class, right? But here it says, number one says WhatsApp, followed by Facebook, followed by YouTube, followed by Instagram, followed by Facebook Messenger, followed by Twitter. Like, why I'm sharing this is for you to know these are the platforms that Nigerians spend most of their time on. So if I want to reach out to Nigerians, if I have a business and my target audience is are Nigerians, I must pay attention to these platforms, because these are the platforms where Nigerians spend most of their time on, right? All right, let me continue. All right, so next slide. Good. Next one says sources of new brand discovery. We all know what brand discovery is. Brand discovery is when you need the service, right? You probably go on the internet to maybe search for a brand that can help you solve that problem that you have, why you need the service, right? So this slide is letting us know where Nigerians go to search for new brands that they want to patronize, basically. new businesses that they want to patronize, right? And number one on that list is ads on social media, right? Social media is very, very huge in a country like Nigeria, because we have people who even sleep on social media, right? They sleep on Facebook, they sleep on Instagram. They can spend a whole lot of their time there, even when they're not even making money from the platforms, right? So social media are platforms where Nigerians spend a lot of their time on, right? So if you want to, if you have a business, and you want to market that business better, or even if you are going to into digital marketing as a career, and you want to help, that means that you want to help other people market their business and they pay you for it, right? So when you are helping other people market their business, you want to help them market their businesses on platforms where they will get results, so that at least they can pay you, or so that at least you can make money and they can be maybe put you on a retainer basis and pay you every month. Right. So and also for those who are looking to gain full-time employment using in the digital space anyways, right? So one of the platforms where people the number one source of brand discovery for Nigerians is ads on social media. That's why you see that every time you're going on social media, there are always ads every time, because it is people spend so much of their time there. So the space is very competitive. Everybody is trying to run ads, right? And the social media guys are making so much money from us. The Mark Zuckerberg and the likes are making so much money from us, right? The next one is retail websites, right? And then followed by ads on TV. I did a full list of all sources of brand discovery, right? Aside digital sources alone, right? And then next one is brand or product website, followed by ads on website. Now, if you look at this list, and then followed by search engine, followed by recommendations on social media, and then after that we have ads on mobile and tablet apps. And then after that, we have TV shows and then customer review websites. Now, if you look at this list, you see that most of these items are digital platforms. The only items that are there that are not digital platforms are, I think, TV shows and ads on TV. The rest are digital platforms. So that's to let us know that people actually use digital platforms the most to discover new brands that they want to patronize or work with. Can we go to the 16th slide? Just jump 15 and go to 16. Good. So next thing is, what are people doing online? People are communicating. People are accessing websites, making purchases on e-commerce websites. People are doing other activities like gaming, reading, checking out photos on platforms like Instagram, checking out videos on platforms like YouTube, right? People are interacting on social media, on blogs and forums, and people are using maps like Google Map, right, to get their way around places. Next slide. All right, good. Now, when you want to go digital with your business, the first thing you want to do is have a unique selling point, or a unique selling proposition, right? People call it USP, unique selling points, unique selling proposition. Other people even call it elevator speech, as you can see that, AKA elevator speech. Now, the reason why I say this, the reason why I advise this, right, is just my personal advice, right? Some other people might teach you digital marketing and they might not tell you this, but this is just my own personal advice. The reason why I say this is because basically what a unique selling point is, it's just one thing that differentiates your business or your brand from other people doing the same thing you are doing. Take, for instance, one thing that differentiates, let's use the telecom brands, for instance. One thing that differentiates MTN from every other brand is the fact that MTN has the widest coverage in Nigeria. I say widest coverage in Nigeria. That's aggregate, yeah, general. There are places where MTN might be bad and Glo might be good. We know that. But if you look at the whole country on the aggregate, right, yeah, you agree with me that MTN has the widest coverage, right? And that's one thing that differentiates them, right? And you can tell that MTN is basically expensive, their data is expensive, even maybe their calls might be even expensive, but we all know that their data is much more expensive than others, right? And you will see that MTN, knowing that Glo, Globacom or Airtel has cheaper plans, they are not trying to reduce their prices, because can we go back to the 17th slide? You've clicked on 15. Okay. So, and you can say MTN are never trying to reduce their prices to accommodate Glo customers, because the Glo customers are people that they want cheap data, even if it's very slow. I'm sorry, I'm not attacking Glo here, but it is what it is, right? People, they want cheap data. They can't afford to spend so much on data. Even if the data will be sluggish at the end of the day, they just want cheap data. They don't have so much money to spend on it. And you see that MTN will not care about the Glo customers, because they are not their target audience. So now, one thing I tell people is that you must have a target market. You must have a target audience. There is no way, okay, then let me talk about target audience. Yeah, I'll talk about it later so I don't jump, right? So you must have that unique selling point. That thing that differentiates you from other people doing the same thing you do. Look at auto brands, automobile brands, for instance. You know brands like Mercedes-Benz, you know brands like Toyota. These two brands are actually doing the same thing. Convey you from point A to point B. That's what they're doing. But Mercedes costs way, way higher than Toyota. And people that want Mercedes feel like they want Mercedes. Instead of Mercedes or nothing, their Mercedes will spoil. They'll go and buy another Mercedes, even when they know that they can get five Toyota cars for the same amount they are buying the Mercedes, right? It's because Mercedes has created a unique selling point for them. And that unique selling point for Mercedes is actually comfortability and premium. And if you see, that's what Mercedes is trying to sell. Not the car itself. Mercedes is trying to sell the unique selling point, because it is that unique selling point that their audience relates to. And that's why those people will know that they can't get this unique selling point anywhere else. So they will stay with Mercedes no matter what. Do you understand? So what I'm trying to say is that for your businesses, have a unique selling point. You must have that unique selling point, because if you pitch your business to me and I tell you that, okay, I've seen someone who does the same thing yesterday, why should I patronize you? And then you don't have anything to say that knocks off the former person, then it means that you're not started yet, right? So there must be that unique selling point. And the reason, another reason why I advise this is because the internet is filled with people doing the same thing you're doing. There's no new thing you're bringing. There's nothing new that you want to bring. We're all modifying the same idea. That's all we're doing, right? Konga, Jumia, go online. Any idea you have, go online and search for people doing it. You'll find so many people doing it. So now the problem now is how do the target market, how can they differentiate who to work with, who to do business with? And that's why the USP comes in play, right? And don't get it twisted. Some people will relate with you, some people will like your business because of your USP, and some people will actually hate your business or dislike your business because of your USP. It's fine. Your business cannot serve everybody. That's one thing you should get out of your head. Your business can never serve everybody. Your business is not jollof rice. Even jollof rice, some people eat jollof rice, right? So your business can never be like jollof rice. You cannot serve everybody. You must have that target audience. MTN have that target audience and they're looking for ways to reach out to that target audience alone. You can't market to everybody. It's not possible. So have a target market and focus on them and move on with your life. Your target market will be enough for you to sustain your brand. Do you get? As basic as water is, This is the example I give people, as basic as what water is. Once you put it inside a pack and you put a name to it, then it's branded. For instance, table water is not for the overly poor. The overly poor are people that live below $1 per day. You can't tell someone that lives below $1 per day to come and buy table water of, let's say, 100 naira. A dollar is about 400 or something naira. So you can't tell someone that's living on $1 per day to come and buy table water of 100 naira or 150, depending on where you're buying it from. It's not possible, right? So it means that even as basic as water is, it has a target audience, right? Even that, and that example I give people is even religion, Christianity, right? We know there's RCCG, Redeemed Christian Church of God, there's Winners. Look, for instance, RCCG's slogan is holiness, Winners is faith, right? So even as general as we think Christianity religion is, once there's a name to it, then it's branded. And it has to have a target audience, right? I'm sorry for using that example, but I just like to just chip it in to make the audience understand better. Next slide. All right, good. So now we know that the first thing when you're going digital is to have your USP. You must have that when you begin to go digital. That's very, very paramount. That's very, very important, right? Now, the next thing here now is when you're crafting your strategy, the first thing is to set a goal. There must be a goal. Because we all know that if there's no goal, just imagine football without a goalpost, then there's no way we'll know who is winning, who is losing. The person that's losing, there's no way they will know what to work on. Or like, if there's no goal, if you're doing something and there's no goal, there's no way to measure progress, and there's no way to measure to know how far you still have to do. So there must be a goal. And that goal, those goals can evolve over time, right? The goal, for instance, when you're starting out your business, the goal for the first 3 months or for the first 4 months might be to have your online audience. At least let me have a bit of followers, let me have a bit of community online. Because once you have your social media platforms and there's no community, nothing, then when you are doing your post, nobody's seeing it. So the first thing will be to have a community. Okay, we want to grow our followers. We want to have up to 5,000 followers. We want to have up to 1,000 followers. We want to have up to 10,000 followers. And you put a time on it because it's a goal, right? So that there has to be a time on it. After growing your followers, the next thing can be, and these goals can evolve over time as your business grows. It's just like the way a human being grows. When you give birth to a child, the first goal for that child will be to probably sit. After sitting, crawl, after crawling, stand, or something like that, right? So this goes as your business grows. Once you say that you want to have a community of 5,000 people in the first 3 months, once you achieve that goal, something else pops up, right? Maybe to get most of them to buy from us, get most of them to engage us, get most of them to go to our website. Let's drive traffic to our website. So those goals evolve over time, but there must be a goal at different times, at a particular time, right? The next thing here is creating a sales funnel. Now, most of us who have maybe taken a digital marketing course somewhere would have heard about sales funnel, and probably would even understand what it is because it's too much grammar, right? Sales funnel, right? But basically, what sales funnel is just the platform where your selling activity happen on. That's all. For instance, Jumia's sales funnel is their website. If you want to buy from Jumia, you have to go on that website. Right, I know Jumia has agents, right, with agents that help you buy, but even those agents, when you give them money, they go on the website to make the purchase, right? So that's their sales funnel, right? For most of these Instagram vendors, those that sell shoes and bags on Instagram is their sales funnel. So what sales funnel basically is just the platform where your selling activity happen on. That's all. And it can be multi-platform. It can be your sales funnel, it can be a combination of different platforms put together. For instance, look at our banks, right? Financial institutions, our banks, they have multi sales funnel. You can do WhatsApp banking, you can open an account on WhatsApp, you can go to the banking hall. Let's even leave banking hall, let's talk about the digital platforms alone. You can do WhatsApp banking, you can open an account on WhatsApp, you can open an account inside their app, right? You can open an account on their website. So these are three platforms that they're using. And I don't know if they have more platforms, but these are the most popular ones, right? So it can be a combination of different platforms put together when you are doing your selling, where you do your selling activity. So let's say, for instance, you sell bags, or you sell shoes, or you sell clothes, thereabouts. You can be selling on Instagram, you can be selling on WhatsApp, you can have a website where you sell on the website, you can sell on social media, you can sell on different platforms, as far as you can manage the processes on all these platforms. So that those are your sales funnel, right? So when you create the sales funnel, when you decide what your sales funnel is, right, the first thing you want to do is to attract people into that sales funnel. The process of attracting here, let me use an offline analogy to explain this better. The process of attracting here is just getting people to come to the sales funnel. For instance, for Jumia, the process of attracting for Jumia will be driving traffic to the Jumia website, right? Attract means, like, for instance, when you go to Computer Village, those of us that are very familiar with Computer Village, when you go to Computer Village, you want to buy a phone, you're walking inside Computer Village. At some point, you see some people dancing in front of a shop. Maybe inside the shop, they sell phones and laptops and things like that, right? You see some people dancing, playing music, dancing. And then when you look at them, you see that there's a shop behind them. That dancing activity, what they are doing is that they're trying to attract people to see the shop, right? That's what they're doing. So when you see all these Jumia adverts on social media, all these fine adverts you're seeing, fine clothes, fine shoes, fine phones, trying to get traffic to their website, that's the process of attracting, basically, right? The next thing is to engage. Engaging here means that for businesses that have different products, for instance, if you're into fashion, you sell fashion items, you're probably selling shoes, selling bags, selling clothes, and things like that, all these fashion items. So these are different products. Even if you're into service, right, you might have different services to meet different needs, right? But the thing here is that imagine you walk into a boutique, a fashion boutique, you walk into, and you want to buy shoes. And you walk into the boutique, and someone and an attendant just comes to take you to the section where bags are displayed. Meanwhile, you want to buy shoes. It didn't ask you anything. Just come to carry you, take you, and then take you to where bags are. Meanwhile, you want to buy shoes. You probably get offended and tell the person that, what's wrong with you, right? So here on the internet too, once you have different services or different products, you need to engage your audience to know exactly what their problem is so that you can serve personalized messages to them. So you don't send information about bags to someone who's actually interested in shoes. Imagine, you know there's a way you go on Jumia, you go to their mobile phone pages, and when you leave that page, everywhere you go on the internet, you see advert about Jumia phones, right? Now, that's because the website has actually engaged you to know what your problems are, and then kept your record. It's not simply they're keeping your record in form of a data, in form of your name or your email address. No, it's always arch data in sense that only the website, only the machine understand that it is you, right? A human being will not see your data, right? When you go on this website, and every time you go on a website, you see ads by that brand everywhere, right? What websites do is that when you go on a website, there's something called Kitsch. I don't know if you see that in your browser, something called Kitsch and cookies, right? What this Kitsch and cookies do is that when you go on a website, the website itself records your browser cache and cookies, right? And the advertiser, the owner of the brand, can actually run adverts to those who have gone on the website before, right? So the website has engaged you. You went to the website, you went to different pages on the website, right? And the website now understands what your problems are, right? And then gives that information, not that it literally gives, but provides the owner of the website the option or the ability to run adverts about that product to you everywhere you go on the internet. So it's just the process of engaging. And engaging can be in different form. It can mean that someone, maybe your sales funnel is WhatsApp. When someone messages you on WhatsApp and tells you that they want to buy, the first thing you want to ask them is what do they want to buy, right? What are the problems? Because if you know someone's problem, that's when you know what to say to make them tick. Do you understand? Because marketing is way more than making people feel like they want your product, right? I tell marketers that don't make people feel like they want your product. Make them feel like they need your product, because there's a difference between wants and need, right? If I feel like I want a product, if I can't afford it, I leave it for maybe someone to come and buy for me. And if I don't get someone to buy for me, I move on with my life or find an alternative. But if I feel like I need a product, for instance, the Mercedes-Benz gang, right? They feel like they need Mercedes. So even when one Mercedes car spoils, they go to get another one because they feel like they need it. It's like, if I don't get this thing, I will die, right? That's how marketers are supposed to make people feel. Not literally that they will die, but at least they feel like they need it. I'm just using that as an example. Next slide. I think you've jumped. Yeah, next slide from here. In 19th, okay, good. So after engaging, next thing is nurture. Nurture here is the things you do, because most times it is fine for people to see your brand, they're interested in your service or your product, but they're not ready to buy. It is fine. It is not a bad thing. The only thing that will not be fine is if you do have a way of converting them into paying customers in the long run. That's the thing that will not be fine, right? But it's fine if they are not ready to buy currently, right? And this is where nurture comes in play. Now, nurture here are the things you do. Nurture here are the things you do to make them want to buy from you when they are ready to buy, right? For instance, sometimes you see our banks, right? You see that when they send you happy birthday messages, they send you happy new month messages and all that, right? Now, these guys are doing this thing so that whenever you need a financial service or whenever you need a financial service, they're the first brand that comes to your mind. For instance, if you have Access Bank account, you have GT Bank account, and every time Access Bank sends you happy birthday, they send you happy new year, they send you happy new month and things like that. But GT Bank does not send you anything. When you need a financial service, you probably remember Access Bank before you remember GT Bank, because these guys have been keeping in touch with you over time. Do you get? So once you have your business and you're attracting leads are potential customers, make sure you have a plan. Even when these leads don't convert over time, make sure you have a plan to make them convert in the long run by nurturing them. What we call that process, nurturing cold leads to become warm leads. That's what we call it in digital marketing, nurturing cold leads to become warm leads. So you must nurture, right? And the next thing is desire. Now, a marketer, as I said before, a marketer makes people feel like they need the product. So you must create desire. So people must desire your product. They must desire you. They must desire your brand. Do you understand? And that's how they feel like they need your product. And the next thing is sell. Selling is the process of exchanging the product for a legal tender, money, basically. And then last thing is deliver, right? Deliver is the things you do after selling. Now, if you look at all these processes, all these stages, attract, engage, nurture, desire, sell, deliver. These are the activities in marketing, if you look at it. Because I told you that marketing is everything you do to achieve your business goals. Now, these activities can be grouped into three. There are activities you do pre-selling, the activities to do during selling and the activities to do after selling. And now you see that here, looking at this list, attract, engage, nurture, desire. These are activities to do before selling. And then there's sell there, which is selling. And the last one is deliver, which are activities to do after selling. And these are stages. These are stages of activities that come together to form your marketing activities, right? Next slide. Good. So now there are two types of competitors, right? When you go digital, please always pay attention to your competitors. Some people feel like, my competitor. All right, Edison, you said my time is running. No worry. From here, I'll be fast somewhere. So there are two types of competitors. We have the direct competitors and the indirect competitors. The direct competitors are just people that sell the same thing that you sell. For instance, look at Milu and Bonvita. They are direct competitors because exactly the same thing. But if you look at Milo and LinkedIn Tea, right? Those are indirect because you can replace one with another, but it's not exactly the same thing. Next slide. So if you are going digital, another thing you must know is know the trends in your business. Please always know the trends in your business. The trends in your business are things that are making money for people in your business at a particular time. For instance, in the fashion world, right? Nobody sells baggy trousers to males anymore. Men don't wear baggy trousers anymore. So if you are selling baggy trousers at this time, you probably, please, can we get the soft copy of the, I'm sure you're gonna get the soft copy. I think Edison will do that. So there are trends in your business. I think we come back to the former slide.
Ignore the comments for now. We'll read them to you. Just focus on your presentation. You're doing well, there's so much to share. So please use your time well. Right. Thank you.
Around the 22nd. So the trends in your business are things that are making money for people in that industry at that particular time. So I'll say that if you are selling baggy trousers at this time, I'm sure you'll not be making money because they don't wear it anymore. People don't wear them anymore, right? So because there are trends in every industry has trends. So you must know these trends. You must research your competitors, their business model, their promos. Go and see your competitors. What are they doing online? And how can you inculcate that to your business? Research both local and global businesses. Research their price points. Price points is how they price people. Do they do instrumental payments, instrumental pricing, after selling pricing or before selling, those kind of things. Research their advert copy. Advert copy is just advert content. What kind of content do they use to advertise their product? Do they use videos, pictures, text alone, GIFs? We know what GIFs are. The GIFs are those pictures that look like videos. Next slide. Yeah, so I said it already, right? Your target market can never be everybody, right? I said it already. It can never be everybody. Know your target audience, right? And it's very, very, very important because once you begin to take the practical class, you want to run ads on Facebook. Facebook will ask you your target audience. They will ask you for their location, ask you for their interest, ask you for their age range, ask you for their gender. So if you don't know your target audience, what will you put here? You just be targeting everybody, and everybody cannot be your customer because, as I said before, your business is not jollof rice. Not everybody will like you. So have your target audience. Next slide again. All right, good. So everything we said so far is just an introduction to what digital marketing is. Now, digital marketing has different components, right? I think we are probably going to end the session just looking at some of these components. Right? Because I'm sure if you don't take some of the components, it looks like we've not done anything. But for me, I feel like having an introduction to what digital marketing is will help you when you're going online, right? Because most time when you hear digital marketing training, you probably want to hear Facebook and Instagram from the onset, right? But you need to have that introductory session to understand what marketing is first, understand what digital marketing is first before we begin to talk about the components. Now, digital marketing, as I said before, is not just about Facebook and Instagram alone. It's an umbrella body for so many things put together. Right, and under digital marketing, we have social media marketing. You don't write this down, you will see them in the slide. We have social media marketing, we have email marketing, we have blogging, we have search engine optimization. Some of us might have heard about these terms before. We have search engine marketing, we have display advertising, website development. There's so many of them. Even graphic design is under digital marketing. And so these are components of digital marketing or components under digital marketing. But the most important, the one I feel like is the most important, this is my own personal preference anyways, the one I feel is the most important is social media marketing. And that's because I feel like social media are a platform where people spend most of their time on. You don't spend most of the time on your email. You probably just go to email when you have a new notification or when you want to check an email sent to you previously, right? But on social media, you can go on social media, you can spend an hour on social media. You can spend more than an hour on social media. So that's why I feel like social media marketing is the most important digital marketing digital marketing components. So social media sites are just computer-mediated online tools that people use for engaging in social activities. They're just online platforms that people use for engaging. Forget all this big grammar you're saying here. Social media sites are just social platforms that people use to engage in online, engage in social interactions online. That's all. That's what social media sites are. Next slide. So we have social media platforms like the most popular in this part of the world. Next slide again. The most popular social media platform in this part of the world, they are Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn. We have platforms like TikTok, Trailer coming up, but these are the most popular. Next slide. Very good. So what you should be doing on social media channels, one, you should be listening. As a business, you should be listening to what people are saying about your business. One thing people do is that when you see someone place a negative comment about your brand on your social media platform, you go and delete that comment, even when you are guilty. Please, that is wrong, right? Maybe in the practical class, I'll teach you things, you'll learn things to do when you have negative comments or negative reviews online. You see that in the practical class. But basically what I'm saying is listen to what people are saying about your brand and use that to build your brand, your business better, right? Engage with your customers. You must engage. The reason why, there's something I say that some people feel like it's my business. It's this social media platform is for my business. It's my business page. So I have to post some business related content. That's to be serious. That's to be a serious platform because it's for business. See, it is called social media and not serious media, right? So whatever you are doing, even if it's a business, you have to be social, right? But social does not mean you should go and post any comedy and all that. Social in your industry. Post social contents about your industry. Right, so it's called a social media platform. The only way to get the best out of social media platforms is to be social. That's the best way, right? So of course, you must post great content, right? That is easily explained, right? You must post great content. You must develop exceptional social media campaigns for several events or products, right? If you have different products that are not interrelated, you must have separate social media platforms for this for this kind of business. For instance, you are into you sell fashion products and you're also into something like real estate. You can't merge those two businesses on one business page. It's not possible because those are two businesses that are not even related at all. So you must have separate social media platform for those kind of businesses, right? Do posts that support your marketing and business goals, right? Of course, that is explanatory. Do posts that support your marketing and business goal. You can use social media for customer service. You can organize competitions and give rewards to loyal customers. Yes, that's another way people use to market themselves online. You can also do paid advertising. Paid advertising is a practical something. So I'm going to be talking about it here. These are just sponsored adverts you see online. Next slide. Next slide again. So talking about the social media platform, we have Facebook. Facebook is the most popular. We all know. Yeah. Facebook, they own Facebook, they own Instagram, they own WhatsApp. They also own a platform called Oculus, but most of us might not know what Oculus is. It's a VR, it's a virtual reality platform. But majorly, they own Facebook, they own WhatsApp, they own Instagram, and they are Facebook is like the reigning, the biggest social media platform, because they have all this platform owned by them, right? They also own Facebook Messenger, right? So it's the most popular. It's one that has the most data. They have the most people on it. They are the reigning champ. And for instance, if you are into photography, for instance, you probably want to use Instagram because your business is photo centric, right? And there's no way you can use Instagram well without Facebook. You realize that in the practical class. In the practical class, there's no way you can use Instagram very well without Facebook. Even WhatsApp, there's no way you can use WhatsApp very well without Facebook. All the Facebook guys have like connected all these platforms together in a way that Facebook is the parent company and all the rest rely on Facebook basically. So it's the reigning champ, it's the biggest. Next slide. So ways to use Facebook for marketing. You have to have a Facebook business page. How to create a Facebook business page for those who can't, will be in the practical class. You see how to create a Facebook business page, how to even brand your Facebook business page to attract customers and leads, right? You also create advertising. They are called ads. We call them ads, right? Sponsored ads, Facebook ads, sponsored ads. That's what they are called, right? And you can also host contests. These are ways to use Facebook for marketing and branding, right? You can also host Facebook contests. You can use Facebook groups also to market your business. And you can also download your Facebook content database. all this we do. This, all these are practical things that you see in the practical course. Next slide. Okay, yeah. So how to use Facebook groups for marketing. Yeah. So people also use Facebook groups. We're on Facebook groups now. Most of us are even in one now. We don't even know, right? All those groups are there to come and join group. Now, so many people use this kind of groups for marketing. For instance, if you're into real estate, one assignment I can give you right here is go on Facebook, search for real estate groups in Lagos. You probably see plenty groups about real estate. And you see that they're using these groups to actually market real estate products. That's an idea I've given you for marketing. So I think you should pay me for that. All right. So you can actually use those groups to market your product. Not only real estate, you can just search your industry. And go to the groups segment. You probably see plenty of groups around your industry. And the audience of these groups, you probably see some groups having up to 100,000 audience, 200,000 members and all that. You can use this group for marketing. Sometimes these groups are actually regulated, right? Which you said that when you go to the group, right? Next slide. Yeah, so let's talk about Twitter. I think Twitter is the one that is most people can use Facebook and Twitter, Facebook and WhatsApp very well. But when you say things like Twitter, but yeah, man, this Twitter, I don't understand though. This follow, I don't understand. But what Twitter basically is a micro blogging site. It's called a micro blogging site because it is content driven. You probably hear people tell you that if you're posting on Facebook and Instagram, post just twice daily or three times daily. But on Twitter, there is no rule to how many posts you do on Twitter. You can do 1,000 posts on Twitter in a day, as far as you are saying something that makes sense. As far as you're not sounding like someone that doesn't have sense, right? Because it's content driven, right? You can post as many times as possible. It's called a micro blogging site because you can continue to post your thoughts on the platform because that's what the platform is for. You see all these influencers, the likes of Omojua. You see that. In a day, they can do up to like 150 posts, 100 to 200 posts, because that's what the platform is for. It's content driven and it is most popular amongst the youths. So if you have a brand that you know that your target audience is those between 18 to let's say 30, you probably want to pay attention to Twitter. Those who are tech savvy between that age range, you probably want to pay attention to Twitter because those people are majorly on Twitter than any other place. Next slide. So Twitter marketing. You must have your Twitter marketing strategy. Another thing I say is that social media marketing is, out of all components of digital marketing, social media marketing is the most diverse because there are different social media platforms. And what works on one social media platform might not work on another social media platform. For instance, on Twitter, when you are doing a post on Twitter, we call them tweets anyways, right? When you're doing a tweet on Twitter, right, you're only allowed to do 280 characters. Yeah, yes, 280 characters. 20 characters, including your footstops, your spaces, your commas, everything. It must be 20 characters. But we know on Facebook, you can do something very long. So what that says is that what works on Facebook might not work on Twitter. A content that works on Facebook might not work on Twitter. So you might need to have your Twitter marketing strategy separate, your Facebook marketing strategy separate. For instance, on Instagram, you can't post without a picture or a video. But on Twitter and Facebook, you can post without a picture and video. That means that you can say that Instagram also has its own uniqueness. So all these platforms, at some point, they have their own uniqueness, and you might want to like craft a strategy that play around their uniqueness, right? So you must have your Twitter marketing strategy, create an hashtag. You will learn what an hashtag is in the practical class, right? Don't let me go too deep into it because it's just an overview, right? Have your hashtag, post regularly on Twitter, don't overpromote yourself, post quality content. Next slide. I'm trying to like brush up so that I can at least finish Twitter and Instagram. If I finish Twitter and Instagram, I'll be good, right? So there are some useful apps that you can use when you are trying to use Twitter for marketing, right? One of them is called Crowdfire. Crowdfire is an app that can help you, like, you know, sometimes when you follow someone on Twitter, you get a direct message from them immediately, right? That's done with Crowdfire. It's a tool, it's an app, right? I don't know if it's available for Apple users, but I know it's available for Android users. I use Android. But Apple users, you can also set your app store to see if it's available for you. But Crowdfire is an app that can help you do that automated direct messages, right? Aside that, it can also help you look at your followers and tell you how many of your followers are inactive, and how many are active. It can also tell you those you are following, how many of them are active, how many of them are inactive. That's what Crowdfire can do for you. And that one is called Hashtagify Me. Hashtagify Me is a platform, is a website. It's called hashtagify.me. If you are, for instance, crafting your Twitter marketing strategy and you're not sure the kind of hashtags to use in your posts, Hashtagify Me can suggest the hot trending hashtag that you can use for your marketing activities. That's what Hashtagify Me is for. And it's another one called Tweet Reach. Tweet Reach is a website that can help you track hashtags. For instance, you've been posting with one hashtag over time for the past, let's say, 1 month. And you want to see how many people have seen the post you have done with this hashtag. Tweet Reach can do that for you, right? You just go on Tweet Reach, put the hashtag there, and it will give you how many impressions that the hashtag has had. Next slide. Instagram, okay, yeah. I think if I can take Instagram, I'll be good. So you can take questions and answers, and you can, right? You can see that the slide is still a bit longer, right? But let me just take Instagram. I'll just take Instagram and I'll go to the last few slides, right? So let me just take Instagram. So Instagram, as we know, is a photo or video sharing platform, right? It's a visual content sharing platform. As I said before, this slide I'm using now, there's still an introductory part in the practical class, and it is this slide, so this same slide. And that one I explained in depth, right? All the slides I explained in depth, right? So today's session is just an overview of what digital marketing is, right? Basically. So Instagram is a photo and video sharing app. It's an audio visual content sharing platform, right? And Instagram is like the best platform for building, for marketing and branding. Right, or let me say it's one of the best, right? Facebook, Instagram, owned by the same people, best platform for marketing and branding, right? And for instance, if your business is into an industry that relies heavily on videos and photos, you must care so much about Instagram. For instance, you're a photographer, you're in an industry that relies on photos. You are a fashion designer. Your business relies on photos and videos. You are a real estate person. Real estate, people want to see the land, people want to see the house, right? This also, like, it might not be you, it might be that you are going into digital marketing as a career, but I'm just sharing this to you that when you get clients, you can know the kind of platform that are good for their businesses, right? So if your business relies so much on photos and videos, then you must care about Instagram. A company into HR, human resource, might not care so much about Instagram because they are not really a company, an HR agency. They're not outsourcing and all that. Those guys might just be on Facebook and LinkedIn and Twitter, and they are good to go, right? That brand, that kind of industry does not really rely on photos and videos, right? So, but if you know that your business relies so much on photos and videos, then you must care so much about Instagram, right? We all know that Instagram is owned by Facebook. Next slide. So we can talk about next slide after Instagram. Just be a bit higher, right? Next slide again. Okay, good. So instead, let's talk about Instagram marketing strategies. Number one, direct message your potential customers. You see this direct message, right? Direct message you directly. Okay, yeah. The first one is follow for follow, right? You might have seen people say this follow for follow. Does it work? What does it mean? What does it entail? Now, basically, what follow for follow means is that you follow people to get followbacks, right? But this can be done strategically. Don't just follow just anybody and get the followbacks, right? There are ways actually do this that will get to the kind of result you want to get. For instance, if I'm into fashion, right? And I want to follow people and so that I can get followers that will be interested in my business. What I'll probably do is go to a fashion brand that has so much followers. Platforms like maybe Mayatafo, we all know Mayatafo, we know what's this guy? This other guy, something Jerry. What's his name? These are fashion guys, people in the fashion distance, right? And they have followers. So what I'll do is that I can go on their platforms and then look at people who engage on their content, right? And begin to follow these people. Because people that engage on their content are people actually interested in fashion. Do you get? So this is a strategy to use for the follow thing, right? And there are apps you can want. Another question you might want to ask is, what if I follow them and they don't follow me back? Right, there are apps you can use to actually know people that don't follow you, and then you can follow them. But that is a more practical thing, right? And then you can create an hashtag. We've talked about hashtag in Twitter, create Instagram and advertisements, which are ads, normal sponsored ads. Optimize your profile to reflect your brand. One thing I say is that when people come to your Instagram profile, they must understand exactly what they do without needing to ask more questions. Once someone comes to your Instagram profile and they start asking questions like, explain your business to me, then there's something wrong somewhere, right? Optimize your profile to reflect your brand. When people visit your page, they should know exactly what you do. Connect your Instagram account to your Facebook account. You know, I said that before, that you can't use Instagram very well without needing Facebook. Network on Instagram, use videos, right? Consider doing photo contests. showcase product of employees, reward loyal followers. Next slide. And I use relevant hashtags. So let me just talk a bit more about hashtags here. I think I'll end here, right? I think it's okay to end here, and then we'll just go to, good. Can you just end? So I can choose, So just stay on this slide, but after this slide, we'll go to scroll down a bit more. Scroll down a bit more. Okay, after this slide, we'll go to the 51. Good, slide number 51, after this slide. So use relevant hashtags, right? So the thing here is this. You know that thing that people do, that they post content about fashion. I'm into fashion, my business is into fashion. And you want to post a content, you want to do a post. I begin to use hashtags like, because you know that these hashtags they are hot, they are trending. You begin to use hashtags like maybe Monday motivation. All those hashtags that are generic, that are not about your industry. Please, those things are wrong. They are very, very wrong, right? Use hashtags about your industry because people follow hashtags. And if people follow hashtags and they are following an hashtag and your business is not about the hashtag, then they probably not pay attention to your post, right? So only use relevant hashtags that are about your industry. And that's why I shared that platform. It's called hashtagify.me. It's hashtagify. You get the slide, so I'm sure you see it. It's called hashtagify.me. Hashtagify.me will help you find hashtags about your industry that you can be using, right? Good. So let's go to that 51st slide. All right, good. So using social media to boost brand awareness. Where are your customers? What social media platforms are your customers on? Then please pay attention to the social media platforms, right? If I'm into HR, for instance, I'll probably pay attention to just LinkedIn and it's hashtagify. Hashtag IFE. So where your customers spend most of the time on those places, be appealing, and be informative. You know, I said it before that it's called social media, not serious media. So you must be appealing, you must be social, you must be human. Don't just speak, listen to what, you know, I said it that you must listen to what people are saying about your business. Always listen as you're speaking, listen to, right? And then be invaluable. Be invaluable means that make sure that you put you, you must get to the point where your social media platforms are they are indispensable to your audience. You know, when you go on social media, there's some brands that when you go on social media, you just want to see their content. If you don't see their content, you feel like you're missing out on something. It's because those brands have made themselves invaluable to you. And you must make your business get to that point. Because that's where you can get the best, right? So images are everything, videos are even better. And then know if it has made a difference. Next slide. Could I talk about influencer marketing? I think I'll probably end here. So let me talk about influencer marketing. So influencer marketing is, there are just two slides more. Okay, I can take the main two, right? I'll take them in 5 minutes. So influencer marketing is actually using influencers to market a business. You see all these Brother Shaggy's, the Plastic CLA knows. You see them sometimes where they're doing their skits, they save adverts in between skits. Like this is actually using other people to actually market a business, right? And it's also a very good tool, right? Influencer marketing help you build trust faster. Right, especially if you're marketing a business like a bank, like a real estate brand, even a real estate brand needs influencers at some point because before people can buy these services, can purchase from these kind of businesses, they want some level of trust, right? A new bank is telling you to come and open a bank account with them to put their money there. You want some level of trust before you do that. A real estate brand wants to come and buy land. You want some level of, you can't just, because real estate is not something you buy for 5,000 naira or 10,000 naira. It's going into millions. So you want some level of trust before you can buy from them. But if you see someone like Brother Shaggy or Lassie CLN advertise the business, you probably want to trust the business more because you're seeing that there's someone that you trust that actually trusts the business. So it's a way of the influencers rubbing their trust off on the businesses. And influencers, it's not only the Brother Shaggy's that are influencers. Even there are lower influencers like people that have 50,000 followers, 10,000 followers, 20,000 followers. The major thing is that they have a large following and their audience trusts them. That's all. They can influence the audience to make some decisions. That's all. It's not compulsory that they must be celebrities, right? So it's a powerful tool. It's social. It's very good. Sometimes when you see sponsored adverts, you don't pay attention. You just scroll through. But if you see influencer marketing, you probably want to pay attention because you want to watch it. If you're a fan of Brother Shaggy, you probably want to watch his video. And sometimes Brother Shaggy can save adverts in between his videos. Next slide. So building your social media followership, right? create a strong social media profile. I've talked about that. I've talked about optimizing your social media platform to reflect your brand. Create a strong social media profile. Share quality content. These are things that I've talked about before. Use friend finding features. Friend finding features are those platforms where, you know, when you register for Instagram, they tell you that some of your friends are on Instagram. Should you connect with them? Those are friend finding features, right? Add links to your top social media account to your website. If you have a website, add the links to your social media account there too, so that people that go to your website can see your social media platforms. Add links to your top social accounts to your email signatures. You know, sometimes when you receive emails from people, you see the signatures at the bottom where you see their social media platform, right? You can also do that to help you boost your followership, so that when you send emails to people, they can also follow you, right? Cross-promote your social media platform. Cross-promotion means that you are strong on Instagram, but you're not strong on Twitter. You can send your Instagram audience to also follow you on Twitter. That's cross-promoting, right? Follow your target Twitter audience and engage with them. Follow your target market. They can follow you back and they can engage with them. Respond to engagements. Use Twitter advertising. Use Facebook advertising. Use Instagram advertising. Use hashtags. Participate in LinkedIn groups. These are just strategies that you can use to build your followership on social media. Next slide. Yeah, final slide. All right. So if you are looking at going into blogging, right? Some people, like, you know, Linda KG, you want to go into blogging. I have a blog myself, and blogs are actually good for businesses too, right? But if you look at going to blogging, Twitter is a platform that you must pay attention to, because I said it is content driven. If you're going into blogging, you're probably posting multiple content on your blog at a time. By posting two content today, two content tomorrow, or one content today, tomorrow, next tomorrow. So you want to pay attention to Twitter, because Twitter is a very good tool for driving traffic, right? You can also have a Facebook page for your blog, post regularly, share content on Facebook, implement social sharing tools on your website or your blog. Social sharing tools are those tools that when you go to a website, you see an icon a Facebook icon. You can click on it and share the website content. Those are social sharing tools, right? And then when you're writing your content on your blog, use catchy headlines and then write compelling content, right? So that's final thing. Yeah, that's the final slide. So yeah, so the essence of this session, to conclude, the essence of this session is just to make us know how digital marketing can help us, right? How digital marketing can help us and why we should pay attention to it, right? And why we should pay attention to digital marketing, basically. And I hope I've been able to do that with this session. So on this note, I hope I've been able to convince you and not confuse you that digital marketing is a very good tool for marketing your business. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm done. I think we can take questions and answers now.
Okay, thank you, Tunde. Thank you so much. I really appreciate. Mrs. K, I want to share the poll now, so that everyone can quickly take the poll.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, please let us use, it won't take more than a minute to just attend to the poll. Thank you, and you can just say done on the chat box if you are done. Please just write down so we know that people are attending to the poll. Thank you. Yes, I can see that from Gabriel. Thank you, Grace. Thank you.
So we need more people to complete the poll. We have 20 people so far. Cool.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Keep it coming. If you have any questions, please kindly use the chat box, or you can signify by raising your hands. But while we wait for those questions, thank you, Mr. Gunawo. I really appreciate for accepting our invitation to come and do this training. Tommy said earlier to everybody, we are going to be 50 people are going to attend the follow-on class. And all you need to do is to attend the assessments that will be sent to us later after the webinar, after the session. The slides was to come in after the webinar, and to come with the just 5 questions, so you can quickly attend to it and submit latest tomorrow. So that will be a basis or a requisite for selecting you amongst the 50 people that will be participating. This is just an introductory class, like you said, and the practical aspects will be coming up later on. The schedule will be sent to you on how to take the classes and how to do the assessment. Certificates will be issued. And one of the things Mr. Ogunowo has promised us is that some of you who have shown keen interest in social media, who probably take the class, we also be given opportunity to get employed. You know, he could refer some of his clients to you, and that would be a means of a gainful employment, or a side also, like we all call it, for those of us that are in school. You will notice recently, I think even a few persons have also gotten opportunities to manage other people's social media platforms and get paid by some of us linking them to these people. So you might really want to take the class very serious so that you can get value for this. I really want to appreciate every single person that has joined us today, everyone that has supported us, for everybody following us on social media. I thank you so much. Please also tag your friends, share the videos, tag your friends, and so that they can also join us. They can join us on social media platforms so that they can be notified whenever we're having programs like this. For instance, the 2021-2022 academic session scholarship application is on. And if you're following us on social media, that's the only way you get alerted and get to know that that portal is open at the moment. So please, if you are not following us, just go to, you can even visit our website, www.realworlddreamsolidfoundation, and you can just click the link. If you want to join on Twitter, you can just click the link there, and it will take you to the page. Also, the deadline for that application, for the scholarship application, is 15th of April. It's on the website to apply for it. Or if you have an indigent student you want to refer, you can send the website to them, and also tell them to follow us on social media to be kept abreast with our programs. We have any questions? Okay, none for now. Okay, I think the other question has been answered, which is about the slides. It will be sent to everybody. Everyone that is registered will get the slides. Okay, thank you. Keep it coming. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. On this note, I want to thank the trustees. This is Kamala Fe. Thank you for approving this. Thank you to every other trustees. Everyone that has joined us online, thank you so much. Thank you. I can see that some of the trustees are also online with us. Thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to host this. I really want to appreciate. Okay, there's a question here. Statunde, if I want to take this.
I can't find it here. Was it sent to you personally?
The person says, in what segment can you categorize digital marketing?
When you say what segment, what do you mean? What do you mean by segment? I think, can you unmute the person? So maybe I can talk to the person. Maybe we can hear the person better.
Okay. We'll see.
Can person explain better what the person means by segment?
Winston, yeah, you can, I think you can speak now.
If he's not available, Edison, he can always send a question to you by email, and Mr. Oguno would attend to that.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. That's fine, too. I just want to understand what the person means by segments.
Okay, Winston, please, you can send us an email, and he will attend to it. Okay, I think on this note, we have come to the end of this Q1 webinar. I look forward to meeting those of you that will be attending the class. It's been an insightful training, an insightful session, and I myself have learned a lot from this. So thank you everybody for joining. God bless you in your future endeavor.
All right, thanks, bye.
Thank you, Tunde, thank you.